should be in the house of the Lord. That's right. We have made this the house of the Lord. Come on, just worship with us just for a moment. Come on. You came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross. My debt to pay from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Oh, thank you, Lord. Come on, let's lift his name on high this morning. What an awesome God we serve. Oh, thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Lord. We lift your name. Oh, your awesome name. Oh, you're so worthy, Lord. Oh, thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Heaven to earth to show the way. From the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Thank you, God. Lord, I lift your name on high. Oh, thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God. Come on, right where you are, in your cars or wherever you are. If you're on social media, you're watching us, just lift your hands right where you are. God, we lift your name. We lift your name. Your name is worthy. Your name is awesome. Your name is mighty. Hallelujah. Come on, give the Lord a clap or a hunk of praise. Hallelujah. Yes. Pastor Raul Stapp is going to come and give us our opening, and we're going to share the Lord's Supper or communion with you this morning. So if you do not have your cups, just honk your horn and one of our deaconess will come and get you a combo kit. Don't forget to expose the top of that kit and retrieve the wafer, and then expose the second layer of that kit for the juice. We will do that. Pastor Stamp will do that this morning. Come on, Pastor Stamp.
Good morning, everyone. Happy Resurrection Day. Amen. This is hands down the most important day in all of Christendom. This is what our faith stands on. This is what it's about. Had Jesus not risen from the grave, none of us would have hope of a tomorrow. Amen. God is good. And all the time, God is good.
Yes, sir.
Luke chapter 24 and verse 5 reads, "Why are you looking for the living among the dead?" asked the men. "He's not here, but he has been resurrected. Remember how he spoke to you when he was in Galilee, saying, 'The Son of Man must be betrayed into the hands of sinful men, be crucified, and rise on the third day?' And then they remembered his words." We should remember those words every day. Amen. Let's not forget that this is not just about church. This is not just about prayer. This is just not about feeling good. This is about Jesus Christ rose from the dead, rose on high, and is coming back again. Now, is that something to look forward to?
Yes, sir.
Amen. Amen. This is your call to worship. Let's go before God in prayer. Father, thank you. Lord, we want to just thank you, Lord, because nothing we have done in this life and nothing we will do qualifies us to enter into your presence, Lord. We want to recognize today that only that which Jesus did.
Mm-hmm.
Father, you're a just God, just as you are a loving God.
Yes. Yes.
And we know that because you're a just God, you must punish sin, Lord. And you provided the punishment for that sin, Lord. And you inflicted it upon your own son.
Mm.
For that, we thank you. That's the just side of you, Lord. The loving side of you provided grace and forgiveness. And for that, Lord, We say thank you, Father God. We don't want this day to just be about bunny rabbits and eggs and making the kids happy, Lord. We want the kids to know Jesus. It's the only way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes to the Father but by him. Father, this morning, bless the man of God who you have placed over this house, Lord. Father God, bless Dr. Wells as he comes and speaks to us, Father God, that which you have poured in to him, Father God. Bless everyone under the sound of my voice, Lord. Open up our spirits. Open up our spiritual ears and our heart that we might receive the word you have for us this morning, Father God. We thank you for everything you do for us, Lord. Even that which we don't even recognize, Lord, we want to say thank you. And we just pray that everywhere where the unadulterated gospel of Jesus Christ is being preached this morning, Lord, that your spirit may abound, Lord. We thank you and we praise you in the strong name of Jesus Christ. Everybody said, amen. Amen. Does everybody have a communion cup? Everyone? If you don't, raise your hand or honk your horn. All right, there's one. So, some needed over here. We're going to, in the meantime, while we get there, we're going to go to 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. And I will hold steady until everyone has a cup. We still missing a cup over here? Amen, amen. God is good, God is good. Amen. This certainly is different, but nonetheless, we shall honor God and we shall remember God in whatever way that comes. Because the devil is a lie.
Yes.
Technical difficulties, schmextical difficulties. We don't care about that. We don't worship God. Amen.
Amen.
We have people here that have gathered. Good to see you all. And so we are going to honor God this morning. Everybody have a cup now? Anybody missing a cup? Blow your horn. All right. I'm going to take that as a yes. I just heard a no. Run, Santiago, run. All right. I'll go ahead and start the reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Starting at verse 23, and it reads, "For I have received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks. He broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he took the cup after supper and said, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy way will be guilty of sin against the body and the blood of the Lord. So a man should examine himself. In this way, he should eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For whosoever eats and drinks without recognizing the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. This is why many are sick and ill among you, and many have fallen asleep. If we were properly evaluating ourselves, we would not be judged, but when we are judged, we are disciplined by the Lord so that we may not be condemned of the Lord." Real quickly, I just want to share this with you, that in the culture in which this was written, sharing a meal together was an intimate thing. It's the representation of that coming together and sharing a meal that the Lord was sharing with his disciple in that upper room. This is not just juice and cracker time. This is not just a ritual. We need to recognize the body.
Yeah.
The body of Christ. That's us. That's one another. Each one of us is a part of the body.
Yeah.
I don't care if you're a pinky on the hand or a pinky on the toe. You're part of the body. And the body can't function as it was designed without you. We need each other.
Yeah.
Amen. Yes. So let's take of the bread. And Christ says, this is my body, which was broken for you. Let's eat together. And then of the cup, which represents the new covenant in his blood. Let's drink together. Amen. And amen. I know it was the blood.
Yeah.
I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood for me. One day when I was lost, he died upon the cross. And I know it was the blood for me. Come on, everybody sing with me. I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood. For me, one day when I was lost, he died upon a cross, and I know it was the blood for me. God bless.
I love you, Lord. I lift my voice to worship you, oh my soul, rejoice, take joy.
Come on and lift your hands right where you are. Thank you, God.
So,
thank you, God.
Love Jesus.
Anybody in love with him today? Anybody in love with the Lord today? Thank you, God. Hallelujah. Listen, it's okay for you to get out of your cars if you like. There is seats. There are seats up here. A little bit of shade for you to get up under if you want to get out of your cars. But wherever you are, can we just worship God today? This is a great day to magnify the great name of Jesus. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, God. Thank you, God.
I love to hear.
Thank you, Lord.
I love.
Yes.
To sing His praise.
This sounds like music. Thank you, God. Oh, we worship you, Jesus. Thank you, God. The sweetest name. Thank you, Lord.
Yes, it is the sweetest name.
Bless the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Come on, give the Lord a hand clap of praise, or honk your horns. Yes, God, we thank you today. What an awesome God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. The song said, I serve a risen Savior. He is in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. Come on, somebody ought to shout right there. He lives. He lives. Christ Jesus lives in me. What a blessing. What a blessing. Well, welcome, welcome, family. Those of you who are in your cars and those of you who are making your way up under our canopies. Thank God for the cloud cover. Thank you, Jesus, for a little bit of cloud cover. We're so glad that you decided to worship with us this morning. There's so many places around the city that you could have found your way to, but you decided to be here with us, and we are grateful. We are thankful to have you with us this morning. I want to acknowledge a dear friend who has driven all the way from Los Angeles to be with me. She's known me since I was called Chip. That's a long time. That's a long time. But all the way back to 1973, April. Would you appreciate Sister April Watson, Jackson Watson? God bless you. We were chatting yesterday, and it's a long way from LA to Murrieta. And so, wow, I'm going to have to buy you lunch, huh? I'm going to have to buy you lunch. All right. Praise God. Well, would you get your Bibles ready now? Would you get your Bibles? We're not going to keep you long. We know that it's warm, Keisha. We're not going to keep you very long this morning. We want to preach and get out of the way. Amen? Amen? We're so grateful that you are here with us. And I want you to turn in your Bibles. And this might shock you, but we're going right back to Daniel. We're going right back to the book of Daniel. We have been teaching and preaching from the book of Daniel. And we are excited to continue our series entitled Be a Daniel. Be a Daniel. And what we know about Daniel thus far is that he was a man of uncompromising faith. A man of uncompromising faith. And so every Sunday, we're coming to the book of Daniel until we finish it. Every Wednesday night, we're coming to the book of Daniel to study it in depth and precept upon precept. And so we welcome you to join us this morning. I want you to turn to Daniel chapter 7, verse 9. We are in the third part, the third sermon in the seventh chapter. And we're going to bring you up to speed, those who have not been with us up to this point. We're so grateful that you're here with us this morning. Daniel chapter 7, verse 9. Daniel said, I watched till thrones were put in place, and the Ancient of Days was seated. His garment was white as snow, and the hair on his head was like pure wool. His throne was a fiery flame, its wheels a burning fire. A fiery stream issued and came forth from before him. And there were 1,000 thousands ministering to him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The court was seated and the books were open. Daniel said, and I watched then because of the sound of the pompous words from which came from the little horn was speaking. I watched till the beast was slain and its body destroyed and given to the burning flame. As for the rest of the beasts, they had their dominion taken away, yet their lives were prolonged for a season and a time. Keep reading. Daniel said, I kept watching in the night vision, and there was one like the Son of Man. Would you say that? Like the Son of Man? Like the Son of Man. All right, keep looking at that. Coming with the clouds of heaven. He came to the Ancient of Days. Say, that's God the Father. Come on, say, that's God the Father. He came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. Verse 14, key verse. Then to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom. Would you say that with me? Was given what? Dominion and glory and a kingdom that all people, nations, languages should serve him or worship him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away. And his kingdom, the one which shall not be destroyed. Pray with me just for a moment. God, we need you today. God, we need you every hour. We need thee. But God, in this hour, in this specific hour, God, we need the filling of the Holy Spirit. And God, that's not the F-E-E-L-I-N-G, God, but that is the F-I-L-L-I-N-G. God, we need your filling. We need you to fill us with your anointing, oh God. We need your Holy Spirit to be the origin, the root of the voice that is coming out of my mouth, the words that are coming out of my mouth, and may they penetrate the hearts of your people. Oh God, speak to us now. We pray so as you use this broken vessel as your instrument this morning. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. This morning's message is entitled, The King is Coming. Would you say that with me right now? The King is coming. Listen, I'm grateful that the Lord has given us the opportunity to worship together today and celebrate this national holiday that in reality for the followers of Christ is a celebration that we have every Sunday. Easter is recognized as a holiday by the world, but for the Christian, Easter is every Sunday. Now, the kids are happy about that because they think maybe we can get chocolate eggs every Sunday. No! Not getting the Easter baskets and chocolate eggs every Sunday. But you can celebrate Jesus every Sunday. Somebody say amen. Amen. Just like the disciples began to meet together and worship the Lord on Sunday after the Lord's resurrection as the first day of the week to commemorate the Lord's promise of his victory over death, hell, and the grave. Listen, from that day until this day, we remember our Savior. From that day until this day, we rejoice in the Savior. From that day until this day, we exalt the Savior. We extol the Savior. We praise the Savior. From that day to this day, we preach Jesus, his death on the cross of Calvary for the sin of the whole world. From that day to this day, we call sinners to repentance by God's grace. From that day until this day, many have come asking, what must I do to be saved? From that day to this day, many of God's people, many saints, have gone into the earth, their bodies in the ground, but their souls in the presence of the Lord. How many of you have a loved one who knew the Lord, loved the Lord, and have gone home to be with the Lord already? Yeah. Listen to me. They are celebrating the victory of the Lord Jesus Christ on the Resurrection Sunday that took place over 2,000 years ago. And just as we heard last week, as the disciples witnessed the Lord's ascend up into the clouds, they heard the angels declare that the same Jesus, would you say same Jesus? Same. That the same Jesus that they watched leave in this manner is coming back the same way. Yes, sir. Yes, madam. The resurrection of Jesus Christ is good news for the Christian. But can I say, can I tell you that there's some even better news? Come on, somebody say better news. Come on, you need some better news. Listen, without a doubt, his death on the cross, good news. Without a doubt, 3 days later, he conquered death, hell, and the grave. That's good news. But I've got better news. Tell your neighbor, I got some better news. Listen, the better news is he's coming back again. No, 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 you may not understand it. He's coming back again. He didn't just leave us to leave us here. He's coming back for us. John chapter 14 says, I go to prepare a way for you. That where I am, what? What you say? You may be also in my Father's house. In my Father's house. In my Father's house. Anybody know about the Father's house? In my Father's house, there are many mansions. You know what that means? There's a lot of room.
Come on.
He ain't talking about, you know, Beverly Hills mansions. That's kind of a misinterpretation of the text. The text actually says dwelling places. In other words, there's plenty of good room for everybody. You know, y'all get that. Y'all get that when family want to come down to stay. And everybody may not have a bed, but then you can make a pallet. Come on. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Y'all know what I'm talking about. You can go. You know you made a pallet before. Baby, make a pallet. That means get down, put your blanket down on the ground, put your pillow down, and lay down and go to sleep. There's plenty good room. Listen, if you've been following my teaching online, I have been teaching through the book of Daniel. And the book of Daniel is an apocalyptic book. In other words, the book of Daniel gives us a peek into the future. The book of Daniel gives us a look at the events to come. For the past few weeks, we have been looking at Daniel chapter 7, where Daniel has spent the better part of his life as a captive under the Babylon Empire. King Nebuchadnezzar, who captured the Jews of Judah and brought them into Babylon and destroyed their city, by this writing, Daniel says that the king is dead by this time. And by now, his grandson, Belshazzar, has ascended to the throne. And this dream that Daniel is having takes place, according to Daniel chapter 7, verse 1, in the first year of Belshazzar. And so it is at this time that Daniel, who had previously been an interpreter of vision, dreams, and strange writings on walls, is now a recipient of a divinely ordered vision. One that introduces us to some strange beings. Now listen, I know that it's hot out here, and if the sun shifts, feel free to find shade, all right? Feel free to move your chair and, you know, some of you got to just chase it. You got to chase it. So there's some overhang rather up here. You can even move your, I don't care where you go. Stay cool, just stay with me. Amen? Now look, here we find, it is here in Daniel 7, that we find a parallel with Daniel's seventh dream and Nebuchadnezzar's dream of a statue that was a statue about four kingdoms. In Nebuchadnezzar's dream, here in chapter 7, Daniel said he saw four beasts. This is a parallel. But here in this 27th chapter, after Daniel describes these beasts that he sees, another event takes place. That's where we are right now. This another event is where Daniel sees the Ancient of Days. That's what we just read. The Ancient of Days, who we've already learned, if you've been with us, represents God the Father. God the Father, hair white like wool. Please understand that Daniel is not describing these characteristics or features so we can try to put a physical image on God, because you can't.
Nope.
And shame on us for trying. And let me just say this parenthetically. Shame on anybody who tries to paint Jesus as an Italian, as a white man, and even as a brother with a Jerry curl. You can't do it. But here Daniel says, I saw one who we have already known as the Ancient of Days. And it says, and Daniel witnesses, this is our first point last week, we witness what is called the coronation. The coronation of the Son of Man. Who is that? Who is that? Who is that? What is this coronation of? Who is the Son of Man? We've already learned, brother and sister, pray. We've already learned that this Son of Man is Jesus. So check it out. Daniel's having his vision. He's having his dream. He sees the Father bestowing upon the Son the honor of a king. This is what we see here in Daniel chapter 7. But as we began looking last week, we came to understand that in order to understand what Daniel saw in his dream, we must interrogate the text. You all get it. You get it. I see some parents here. I see some moms and dads. And if you don't have teenagers now, you have them. And one thing you know about teenagers, God bless you for those young people who are here. But the one thing we know about teenagers is they lie. Come on, can I get an amen right there? Even the teenager agreed. Yeah, you're right, preacher. You're right. We lie. And so you have to interrogate them jokers. Where are you going? Who are you going with? What time are you going to be back? What's going to be going on there? Is there any parents around? Is there any alcohol around? What's his name? Bring him to my house. You got to interrogate them jokers. Well, if you're going to study scripture, and if you're going to have understanding of scripture, you must interrogate it. What do we say you have to do? You have to ask 5 W's and an H. Parent, this is a parenting tip. My kids are grown. I got a 35, almost 36 year old, and a 33 year old. I know, I don't even know how that happened because I'm 40. But listen, check this out. What's important is that you've got to ask these five questions. Well, who, what, when, where, why, and so far we've already discovered who the dream is about. It's about these four beasts. It's about, if you got to go back and read this, it's about these 10 kings. It's about this one king that comes up in the midst of the 10 kings, where 3 kings are plucked out, taken out of power. That one king rises into power. He speaks pompous words. The dream is about kingdoms. The dream is about a king. Guess what? Oh, we celebrate the resurrection today. Oh, we thank you, Lord, that as you promised in your word, that 3 days in the grave, you would get up from the dead. And we celebrate that you rose just as you promised. Are you grateful that he rose? Are you grateful that he rose again? Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. But let me tell you a secret. Jesus left and he went back to glory. Oh, God. And we are in the middle from the time he left to the time he returns.
So let me connect something for you. Pastor, what happens to the Christian that goes into the grave before the Lord returns? Well, this is what we know. The body goes to the grave. And the body deteriorates. It breaks down. It returns from which it came, which is what?
Dirt.
It goes back to dirt. Dirt, you hear a say at funerals, we take those flower petals, we fluff them over the casket, and we say, ashes to ashes, what?
Dust to dust.
Dust to dust. But Pastor, what about the Christian? What happens to that person where his soul immediately goes to heaven, to the presence of the Lord? Okay, so what happens? 1 Thessalonians, don't turn there. Let me just tell you, let me summarize it for you. 1 Thessalonians, remember, this is our next Bible study. 1 Thessalonians tells us that the last trumpet of God is going to sound. Y'all with us? Y'all with me? The last trumpet of God is going to sound, and the dead in Christ will rise what?
First.
The dead in Christ will rise first. First, wait a minute, Pastor Boyce. How's that? Hold on. The body, my auntie, my uncle, my mother, my father, my son, my daughter, who's been in the grave for 20, 30, 40, 50 years, what, his body, her body has returned to dust. How are they going to rise from the earth? The Lord is going to recreate their bodies. Those bodies are going to come out of the grave, and they're going to take on a new body. Pastor Wells, what kind of body? A body just like the Savior when he came out of the tomb, just like the Savior when he took on a new body, a resurrected body. I feel like preaching a little bit today. Listen to me. So listen, stay with me. So look, so that physical body gets caught up to meet the Lord where?
Yeah.
I'm saying again?
Yeah.
In the air. Listen to me. That is not the second coming of Christ. That's not the second coming of Christ. Because he doesn't come to earth. He comes to the?
Yeah.
To the clouds. And what happens? The soul of the one who died, that went to heaven, meets the body that came out of the grave with the soul. They meet and they become a new body. Well, suppose this event, this cloud event, were to happen while I was still alive. Well, I got good news for you.
Right.
If, everybody say if.
Yeah.
Come on, turn to your neighbor and say if.
Yeah.
Come on, tell somebody, don't play with me. If.
Yeah.
If you have accepted Christ as your Savior, and only if, you too will be raptured. But check it out. In these bodies, in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, you will be
changed.
Y'all see that?
Yeah.
I'm going to do it again because it'll look good. You will be caught up to meet the Lord in the air. And listen to the latter part of that text. And forever.
Uh-huh.
Come on, somebody say forever.
Forever.
And forever we shall be with the Lord. So that's not the second coming. That's the rapture. We got dead Christians caught up to meet the Lord with their souls. My soul and my body gets caught up to meet the Lord. My body takes on a new body. Thank you, Jesus, because I'm trying to lose 20 pounds. But Lord, I ain't ready to go yet. Come on. If you get another body.
Yeah.
Anybody excited about another body?
Yeah.
I know some old folks. Pastor Stamp, I know you excited. You're excited about another body. I know some old folks.
Don't play with me, brother.
I know some old folks excited about getting another body, man. Well, do you hear what I'm saying?
Oh, yes, sir. I do. I am so ready.
Don't leave us yet, sister. Not yet. Pastor Stan, would you reach in my bag and grab my towel for me? So look, according to the dream, there's another event. The second coming, thank you, sir. The second coming has not occurred yet. And so what's happening in Daniel chapter 7, Daniel gets a peek into the future of what will happen. And according to this dream, the Son of Man, who is with the Father in this dream, is coronated, what? The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I mean, wait, hold up, Pastor. Wait a minute. I thought he was already that. So let's make sure you get this here, because now this is important. When Jesus completed his work on the cross, which was the work of redemption for mankind, when Jesus completed that work, the Father showed that he was satisfied that the work that he had completed was good. And so the Father, listen to me, the Father raised Jesus from the dead. He's not done. If you remember correctly, that the disciples asked Jesus, when is all this going to happen? And Jesus says, yeah, you got to ask the Father.
Come on.
Well, what do you mean? I thought Jesus was 100% God and 100% man. He is. But what did he do while he was on earth? You got to get this. And if you don't know this, you better get in my Bible study with me. Jesus, who was 100% man and 100% God, even as God, he surrendered his independent ability to act as God while he was on earth. He gave that to the Father. And so the Father decides what happens.
Yes, sir.
So check one, two. It is not until Jesus is preparing to take up his kingdom that the Father bestows on him the honor of all authority. Remember what he says in Matthew 28, 18? He says, all authority is given unto me. So here, we witness the coronation. The next thing we see in this text, this is April, is the character of this kingdom that Jesus is going to set up. What is this kingdom like? And so I began sharing the character of this kingdom on last week. And what I said, oh, there are five words. Come on, say that with me. There are
five words
that describe what this new kingdom is going to be like. And so what the first word we said on last week, if you was with us, is that in this new kingdom, there would be authority. Go back to Daniel 7, 14, would you? Verse 14. Then to him, that's Jesus, from the Ancient of Days, was given, what's that next word?
Glory.
Anybody else's Bible say something different?
Dominion.
Anybody else's body say something different?
Authority.
Ding, 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 ding. Yes. Authority. Dominion, same word. Glory, same word. Listen to me. This is what is getting ready to happen here. Jesus, in this new kingdom, will be given all dominion. This means that the king will have ruling authority in this kingdom. When he takes this kingdom, all things will be under or come up under the authority of Christ. This means this. You get this. I love talking about my kids. I got a granddaughter who's 15. And so you'll get this. Praise, you guys get this. You'll get this. You get this. You tell your kids,
go wash the dishes. None of y'all kids ever did this, but they smacked their cheek. What? Did I hear noise? That ever happened? You have to remind them, boy, you act like you know something about this. This your grandson?
My grandson.
Yeah, give me a switch. You need a book. I know you done did something. Look. You have to remind them that this your house. Okay, I'm trying to help you. You have to remind them that until the mortgage comes in their name, you have to remind them until they can afford their own health insurance. Come on, I need somebody to pray with me. You have to remind them until they can go down to the Piggly Wiggly or Albertsons or Steak Brothers and buy some food. This your house. And you love them. You love them. You are grateful for them, but you will hurt them. Am I preaching yet? Am I preaching? Okay. So look. Jesus is saying that he has full authority in this domain. Nobody questions him. And listen, this ain't hard. And I'm talking to parents right now. This ain't hard. And I don't advocate child abuse. Amen. I do not advocate child abuse. It's wrong. It's reprehensible. My mama did it to me. I do not advocate it. But a good spanking, not bruising, not leaving marks. Come on, y'all know how to do that. Not out of control. A good spanking reminds a kid who's in charge. And you can let they can listen to their friends all they want. Especially, and I don't mean to offend, especially if their parents are not people of color. Okay, if their parents are not black, sometimes these children say stuff to their parents and your kids are like, ooh. I could never say that to my mama. And you hear some stuff, you want to snatch that little joker up yourself, even though they don't even belong to you. There's some kids you want to beat in the grocery store. Come on, say amen. So Jesus saying, all things will come under my authority. He will reign absolutely. He will reign supremely. He will share his glory with no one. Here's the second word. My first word is what?
Authority.
My first word is authority. Our second word that we see in this character of the kingdom revealed is not only to be complete authority, but there will be honor. Honor. Christ will not only have complete authority, which takes care of controlling all men, but the term honor takes care of controlling all that they think. If you look back at 7:14, it says there was given him dominion and honor. In this kingdom, he will be honored. Not only will he have the power to rule, but he will receive honor from those to whom over he rules. Which, by the way, should start right now. I don't know why I need to say this, but I'm going to say it anyway. This is why God says to children, no matter how old you are, to honor your parents.
Say the rest.
Now I know as a young person, I know that's not always easy to do. Because sometimes mom and dad can be flat out wrong. Am I right about it?
That's right.
They can be wrong. There is no exception to the rule that you only honor your parents when they're right. Oh, God is never wrong. So there is no rule that you only honor God when you like what he has to say.
Come on.
I wish I had some folks to preach to today. Listen, I don't know about you, but I've been saying April knows, I got saved at West Adams with April in 1973. I know you're doing the math right now. You're trying to figure out what? Listen, I've been saved for a long time, and there have been things that I have read in the Word that I disagreed with about God. That I didn't like. That I don't think is fair. And when I get to become God, I get to change the rules. But the truth of the matter is, he's God.
That's right.
And I don't know about you, Frank, but I don't want a God that I can tell what to do. I don't want a God that I can manipulate. I don't want a God. Listen, I'm grateful that God is holy. I'm grateful that God is all powerful. I'm grateful that he knows everything. I'm grateful that I can trust him. Even when I don't like it, I can trust him. First Timothy 6:4 says this, I charge you to keep this command without spot or blame until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 15, which God will bring about in his own time. God, the blessed and only ruler, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who alone is immortal and who lives in unapproachable light, whom no one has seen or can see, to him be honor and might for how long?
Forever.
He has not just the power and the authority, but he has the honor. And I can't help but get excited about that. I know about you. I don't know about you, but the world accepts the existence of this higher power. But listen, the world has no problem using the title God. Oh, you'll hear it everywhere. But listen to me, and you need to hear this clearly. They do not like Jesus.
Amen.
They want nothing to do with Jesus. And the interesting thing about that, I'm going to tell you something. The devil is, listen, if you think you're smarter than the devil, then you are a double fool. You are a fool. The devil is so much smarter than us. Y'all hear me? The devil knows us. The devil, he is not some cartoon character. He's not some animorph anime. He's not, no. He's a real angel. A fallen, evil, powerful being. And he knows us. He knows our weaknesses. Listen, he knows what we thirst for.
Yeah.
He knows what we want that we don't even talk about. It's in the deep crevices of our mind. We don't even have to utter them. But he knows because we have a track record.
That's right.
Yes. Amen.
And that fool keeps track of our failings.
That's right.
Listen to me. He keeps track of this.
That's right.
Satan keeps track of the times we have willfully disobeyed God. Because Satan knows if you did it once, you will do it again. And so he creates this cycle of where he presents to us those things that our appetite wants. Listen to me. Listen to me. I love me some butter pecan ice cream. Father God. And I'm talking right out the oven with the crust on top. Yes. Some peach cobbler, some butter pecan. I love it, but it don't love me. And so when I decide I'm gonna fast, let's just answer this question for me. When I decide I'm gonna fast, why every commercial that come on TV ain't nothing but butter pecan and peach cobbler? I don't care if it's a Ford commercial, they eating peach cobbler. I see it in the car. The devil knows how to tempt us. And so as followers of Christ, our persecution will increase to the point like the saints who have been slain and under the altar in the sixth chapter of Revelation. I'm trying to get you somewhere. And so, listen. In the sixth chapter of Revelation, we witness these believers who came to faith during the tribulation period. Let me give you a timeline. If you're a Christian in this era, the age of the church, the age of grace, if you're a Christian in this era, my theology may not be yours, but my theology is that the church is going to be taken away. And all those who are part of the church, as Pastor Stapp talked about being a part of the body, all those who are part of the body will be snatched away. This is before all of this stuff starts to happen. So, theologically, we who call ourselves Christian in this age will not be here during a period of time that's called the tribulation period, where Satan, through this king who speaks pompous words and persecutes the people of God, there will be a great martyrdom of people who come to faith during that period. As a matter of fact, the only way, listen to me, the only way to survive that period is to die as a martyr. The only way to ultimately join the saints in heaven, if you're on earth after the rapture, you're down here, all hell is breaking loose, and that's a literal term. It's a biblical term. All hell is breaking loose. The only way that those folk will get from earth to heaven would be to become a martyr who rejects, I wish y'all would come to Bible study, who rejects the mark of the beast, who rejects surrendering and worshiping the Antichrist. Now, listen to me. Don't play with God. Don't be boo-boo the fool. Listen. Don't take any chances. Because you know what? You don't know what you will do when you can't buy food. Listen to me. I was a strong advocate. I ain't getting the vaccine. I don't care what they say. I ain't getting the vaccine. Well, you know you're not going to be able to travel. Where do you sign up for the vaccine? You're going on a cruise, really? And you'll need your vaccine card. Where can I get it? But my tone changed. Why? Because there was something that I wanted. And I don't know, honestly, I don't know what the vaccine will do. I believe, I trust that it's safe. But if my last act on this earth, if I were to die, it's going to be on a cruise ship. You'd be like, well, he died sailing the seven seas. Yes, Jesus. So look, these saints in Revelation 6 says, how long, O Lord, how long will you allow your people and your name to be so abused? David said, the reproaches that fall on you are falling on me. The Apostle Paul said he was willing to bear the marks of Christ, but longs that Christ would be exalted. John cried out, even so, come, Lord Jesus. It is enough that you have been dishonored. It is enough that they have rejected you. It is enough that they have despised you. But there will be a day when he is honored in the way he deserves. So we have authority of the kingdom. We have honor of the kingdom. And I'm just going to say this, I'm going to sit down. We have the extent of the kingdom. Let me help you out here. Just how vast is this kingdom that we see here in the text? We'll go back to Daniel 7:14 again. It looks like I'm only going to get to that verse. Kingdom is a word that speaks of his government. It shall be given unto him a governmental structure. In other words, listen to me. In other words, this is important. This kingdom is not simply some spiritual entity. No. This is not just the rule of Christ in the hearts of believers. It's more than just a spiritual thing. Just like there will be four Gentile powers that are real, Jesus will rule in a real live kingdom. Those kingdoms, the United States, in a sense, is a kingdom. It has a head, it has an army, it has citizens. It's a literal earthly kingdom. The kingdom that the king is coming to, the kingdom that the king who rose from the dead will one day reign over, is a literal earthly kingdom. That period will be called the millennial kingdom. It's a kingdom that Christ will set up on the earth for 1,000 years. It's a literal kingdom. And during that kingdom, Christ will rule, and check this, and we will rule with him. That's what it says. So what am I saying, Pastor? Mark, Shirley, I'm saying that we will see that God, in all of his power,
will set up an actual kingdom on earth that he reigns on. And I believe we're going to see this real, literal kingdom on this earth. And I think that it is precisely what the Spirit of God has promised us throughout the scripture. And more distinctly, we see in Revelation chapter 20. I'm going to close with this. Revelation chapter 20. Listen to what John saw. The scripture says, "And I saw thrones, and they sat on them, and judgment was given to them." Keep reading. "And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, and who had not," I just talked about this, look at it, "and who had not worshiped the beast nor his image, nor had taken his mark on their foreheads or in their hands, and they lived and they reigned with Christ 1,000 years. Just a quick note. Don't play with God. You're watching. Today is your day to get this thing right. Today is your day to align yourself on the right side. Today is your day. You're being recruited on a full ride scholarship to align yourself to be on Jesus' team. You do not want to be left down here. You do not want to go through the trouble that those who are left here will go through. You want to be on the Lord's team today. And it starts today. Pastor, what's required? Jesus said that if you believe in your heart. Now listen, you have to understand, that's more than just saying, "Oh yeah, I think Jesus is God." No, no, no. This belief changes our behavior. It's belief that is transformed into lifestyle. Listen, you and I know, I got saved early on, but I didn't always act saved. It took me a while. It took me a while before my conversion was fully authentic. Listen, I was saved, going to parties. And I was okay because, you know, I bought my life insurance. But there was a time period where I acted like a heathen. There was a period of time when I acted like I didn't know him. And then God got a hold of my heart. And then I remember falling on my face before the Lord and saying, "God, I'm sorry for acting like a fool. Forgive me, Lord." Oh, I still mess up. Go tell your neighbor, "You too.
You too."
But listen, I'm different. I'm different now. I don't know if it's age.
It is.
Thank you, Reverend. I don't know if it's age, but I'm different. The problem is, we don't know when our end is coming.
That's right.
Fortunately, I made it to here. And I'm so glad that I made it to here. I'm so glad that his grace has been sufficient and his mercies have been new every morning. I'm so glad that I made it here.
Yes, sir. Yes, indeed.
Listen, church. Listen, friends. Believe in your heart the Lord Jesus. And confess with your mouth. The word confess means agree with God. What do you need to agree with God about? Agree with God about your sinful condition. Agree with God about your need for a Savior. Agree with God that he died on the cross. Agree with God that he went into the grave. Agree with God that on the third day he got up from the grave. Agree with God that he ascended back to his Father. Agree with God that he's sitting right now on the right hand of the Father. Agree with God that there's going to be a trumpet sounding one day. Agree with God that the dead in Christ are going to rise up. Agree.
Yes, sir.
Agree. Say, Lord, I receive you.
Yes, sir.
Lord, I receive you. I receive you to be Lord over my life today.
Yes.
Don't you fool around with that. Don't you wait. Don't you play with God. Because he's taking young people and old people out of here. That's all I'm going to say for today. I just want to remind you, the King is coming. The King is coming. Come on, tell somebody, the King is coming. Come on, tell somebody, the King is coming. Come on and give God some praise. Come on, give him some praise. Come on, give him some praise. Thank you, God. Hallelujah. He's real, real. Jesus is real to me. Oh, yes. He gives me the victory. So many people doubt him. I can't live without him. That is why I love him so. Jesus is real to me. Help me sing. He's real.
Real.
Yes. Jesus is real to me. Oh, yes. He gives me the victory. So many people doubt him.
I can't live without him.
That is why I love him so. Jesus. One more time. Hallelujah. He's real. Yeah.
Real.
Yeah. Jesus is real to me. Oh, yes. He gives me the victory. So many people doubt him. But I can't live with him. Say it again. So many people doubt him.
I can't live.
One more time. So many people doubt him. But I can't live without him. That is why I love him so. Jesus is real to me. Come on, give the Lord some praise. Oh God. Oh God. Oh God. Oh God. Oh God, our Father. If we ever needed the Lord, we need you. Oh God, there may be a young person. There may be a seasoned senior person that have never fully surrendered. And they want to do that today. Maybe they're on social media. Maybe they're here in the parking lot. Maybe they're in their cars or in their seats. Oh God, we come. And we thank you that you are ready, willing, and able to receive them. And so if you're here today and you've never asked Christ to be your Savior, today is your opportunity. Today is your day. Thank you, God. Is God speaking to your heart? Can you say today that you have fully surrendered yourself to him, to his lordship? This is how you do it. Dear God, I confess. I agree with you that I'm really not what I could be. what I should be. And I do not want to play with my eternity. I do not want to play with my salvation. Oh God, I want to serve you. And I want you to lead my life. And maybe there's somebody who just needs to make a reaffirmation, a rededication. Maybe there's somebody who will say, man, I played this game for so long, and I'm ready to dive in with both feet fully submerged into the grace of God. Oh God, would you come into my heart? Will you take away the ugliness of my life and be my Savior and be my Lord? And I will confess you before men, and I trust that you will confess me before the Father. I receive you as my Savior right now. I believe that you died to redeem my soul, that you went into the grave, and on the third day you rose again from the dead. I receive you now. Come into my heart. And I pray for my family today, the family of God today, the people of God in this place right now. God, I thank you for those who came from near and far to be a part of this celebration. God, you're so faithful. You're so faithful. God, we do not know when we will take our last breath on this earth. But we want to know for certain that when we do, we'll be absent from our bodies, present with the Lord. Oh God, I pray for us right now in the name of Jesus. In the mighty and matchless name of Jesus, I pray. And then God, as we prepare to dismiss, God, we want to thank you for the gifts, the offerings, the contributions, the tithe, the tenth, the offerings above the tithe. Oh God, we want to thank you. Thank you that you have sustained our church during this year and a quarter. Thank you that you've been faithful to us. And that God, even when we were faithless, you remained faithful. God, we love you today. We praise you today. We magnify you today. Would you bless our services as we go forward? In the mighty and matchless name of Jesus, we pray. And the people of God said, come on, give the Lord some praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Listen, thank you for being here today. You can give your offering as you leave today. The deacons will be directing you. I want to admonish and encourage you to join us on Wednesday evenings at 7 o'clock right here on our social media page, New Birth Church, or my page, my personal page, Dr. J. Wayman, or you can sign in to Zoom. You can sign in to Zoom, and we will get you connected. We would love to have you. We're still in the book of Daniel, getting ready to go into chapter 8 on Wednesday night. We still got to finish chapter 7 here. So thank you for being here. God bless you. Have an incredible Easter Sunday. Thank you for spending it with us. God bless you, those who joined us online. Have a great Sunday. God bless.